Hey, so it's morning in Ljubljana, Slovenia, and so far I've visited, I think, about four cities. Novo Mesto, that's where Melania Trump was born, although she was raised in Stevanica, which is about 16, 17 miles away from her place of birth. And what's interesting is that she was actually, at the time she was born, there was no Slovenia, it was Yugoslavia. But she was in this city as well. She attended university right here, but she dropped out after 1 year. And she comes from a very humble background, I think a working class background as well. What's interesting is that the city of Stevanica, it's famous for lingerie. And so it's still famous. It was famous back then, and it's still one of the top producers in all of Europe now, which gives you an idea of what being the first mover can do. But it also shows you how the economy can affect your own trajectory, your own life. Because obviously there's probably quite a few models down there that creates the ability for people who move over there to take up that career path. It's the same thing with Bill Gates. His father was a lawyer. That access to money allowed him to purchase a computer for his son at a time when most people did not have access to computers. And of course, the rest is history. Now, one of the things I've learned here after going to Novo Mesto, I think the other one is Koper, which is nearby Italy. This country was occupied during World War II by both the Germans and the Italians. And it's right in the middle of so many different sort of leaders vying for power. So it's had a very difficult history. But of course, now with the EU money, it's quite sanitized at this point. That's part of the fear that I have with most of Europe, is that they're going to kind of wash over their own history in an effort to bind them together in the EU, which is an excellent short-term strategy, but a very poor long-term one. Oh, there's a marathon going on now, by the way, so you'll see a lot of runners. They blocked off the streets. From a long-term perspective, you're very likely to end up, creating a reduction in social cohesion if you try to paper over the truth with advertising slogans. Or worse, just make everything look the same. Now, the other thing I've learned after going to Koper, Novo Mesto, and there's one more. The best one, Bled. That's where a lot of the nature, including the gorge, which is the best experience I've had here. Vintner Gorge, I think it's called. If you come here, that's where you should go. I would probably just spend one night here, see the castle, see the city museum, and then head over to Bled, B-L-E-D, and just stay there. The City Museum, by the way, also has the best coffee in the basement, a place I've never heard of before, but it's absolutely the best coffee. It even has coffee from Chiapas. The name is Stow, S-T-O-O-W. But getting back to what I was talking about with the economy and location, being very much catalysts in people's lives, not just in Melania's, but in all of us, and Melania, of course, was born in an era without, widespread commercial civilian travel. So for her to have gone from Novo Mesto, which is a tiny, it's still a town, not much over there. It's still got the typical layout of a church, farming, and just a lot of green space. So that's why I was able to sort of have another epiphany when I visited Novo Mesto, which is that a couple of things. Number one, I could see why the communists in the Soviet Union were so eager to nationalize the agricultural sector. When they looked at, obviously, Russia itself is a large space, but much of its land is not useful for farming. So if you come here and you see all this green space with a church in the middle, essentially the pre-existing power structure, you can see how, number one, you would want to remove that power structure and replace it with something of your own, as well as try to create a national plan for all of your, territories under jurisdiction, where you would combine the agricultural sector. And remember, the flag is a hammer and a sickle, farmers and laborers. That was the goal. But by the way, anywhere you go in Europe, there's always a church in the middle of the square. And typically, that's probably one of the nicer buildings, at least back then. Certainly, perhaps not now, but definitely back then. And so, if you're a part of the Soviet Union, you've just won World War II. You've agreed to a demarcation of borders with the United States. And so now you've got to try to create a vision that competes with what you consider to be the decadent West. And the way you do that is you nationalize, and this failed spectacularly, by the way, perhaps because the Russians just didn't know how to farm, or they relied on people that just didn't know how to farm either. Because once you nationalize something, you're removing, a couple of things happen. You remove a lot of the best people who move, perhaps to the United States. That certainly happened with the Jewish population in the Soviet Union, much to the benefit of the United States. But it's not just that one population. It's a lot of different people were targeted, simply because after winning the war, you know, the tolerance for dissent, you know, is at an all-time low, especially if you lose 17 to 25 million people in the process of winning that war. What's interesting is that I came across a book by one of Eisenhower's sons or grandsons, and he said, Eisenhower actually said that we had an agreement that allowed the Russians to essentially conquer and, you know, claimed they were the ones that essentially came in with their troops to retake and win the war, Eastern Europe. And Eisenhower said that this is something that I consciously agreed to, simply because I didn't want to go back home to the United States and tell a mother or a grandmother that, you know, we knew we would win. We were, and I think Italy actually surrendered around 1943. So you had a, you know, it's not, when wars typically, the way they're taught, they end suddenly, but that's not true. Whether it's, you know, breaking encryption, which is very well, you know, described in the movie The Imitation Game, you know, whether it's that or whether it's, you know, just a breakdown in communication, in many cases it's a long, long process. So one of the interesting things is that you can see the vision simply because it's, you know, you've got the supply chain, you've got an excellent record in infrastructure. You know, anything that was built by the Soviet Union, whether it's a train or an escalator, and the escalators, when I talk about them, we're looking at underground trains that go with escalators that go all the way to the top, which is a distance. It takes you about, sometimes in some cases, about 3 minutes to 5 minutes just to get from the ground to the top at a normal speed, because it is, they were so, number one, concerned with security. You can't really drop a bunker bomb that far. It doesn't really affect the subway system. But also they were really concerned about creating this infrastructure, this ecosystem that would allow them to prioritize the farmers and the manual laborers and the blue collar workers over everyone else. And what's really interesting is that despite having the hammer and sickle on their flag, the Soviet Union failed to do all of this. In fact, it went to the exact opposite, in the sense that it took away the property, took away the expertise, and then suddenly had a major issue trying to replicate that expertise. And so it tried all kinds of things. It tried to give small plots of land to different farmers. It tried everything. But eventually, it nationalized the whole industry because it was, its plan was to create infrastructure and an ecosystem where you would be able to supply the entire territory under its jurisdiction with food and everything else. And if you have a track record in making things that are essentially indestructible, whether it's a bridge, all the bridges are still here. Some of them go quite far back. Whether it's a train or even a car like a Lada, all these things last a long time. And so that was done specifically to counter sort of this decadent image of having too much debt, of having a lot of sort of superfluous consumer choices. And it didn't work, but it didn't work for many reasons. One, the failure to succeed in farming was probably the number one failure. You can't get food to all these different places that are under your jurisdiction in a reasonable way. Eventually you have rations, eventually people get upset, especially if they look across to the West and they see a different system that's been bolstered by a lot of consumer debt, a lot of corporate debt. And in some cases where, you know, you've had a different system because of the banking structure, where even England was paying the United States, you know, a ton of money, even though it was on the winning side after World War II. The Soviets, I don't think, had a reparation system. They didn't really understand the banking system. They didn't understand the multiplier effect or the entrepreneurship effect, or at least the image of it. And so because they didn't use the banking system effectively in a way that allowed them to grow an insurance business on top of that banking sector, you can see how having one failed harvest can multiply many, many times, especially if you don't know what you're doing when you nationalize the entire sector all across the board. But coming here, you see exactly why it would work on a high level. There's so much green space here. The population is small, the city center is quite small, you can walk the whole thing easily. And you know, whether if you are the Soviet Union and you just won the war, you can see why your system seems a lot better. But not if you have freedom of movement, to the extent that you're, you know, once you nationalize something, you remove that personal incentive, and then you're sort of stuck on multiple levels. You know, one, you're losing your best people, and or you're oftentimes losing your best people to a competitor. But also, if it doesn't work, you know, you're not able to experiment as much because you don't have that developed insurance sector where you can fail. And then the banking sector sort of, you know, sort of has a lot of opportunities to absorb the losses within an overall structure across multiple territories, especially when those territories are paying you millions of dollars in your currency, you know, in total, including on the winning side. So that's kind of an interesting sort of history lesson here. And it's still going on, because I think one of the reasons that it succeeded is because, you know, the United States and the West succeeded was because of the banking sector, which then created an insurance sector. And even if you're in the UK, you can see a lot of your industry in London revolves around banking and insurance. And that's not an accident. that's a very, very interesting, very natural development. And so when we talk about capitalism, we talk about socialism, we talk about communism, all these are different things. You can see that a lot of it really just comes down to execution of your vision. And what's really tragic about the Soviet Union is that it really, had it just figured out how to farm, it probably would have had a viable competitor to the United States and its allies. But because it failed in farming and in banking, you know, and in doing so was able to attract a lot of the East's best people, you know, you can see that the competition has greatly benefited a few nations. That is all changing now. A lot of people are replicating successes much more easily, despite intellectual property protections, which usually favor the establishment or whoever happens to be there, and you know, before you, which of course harms smaller competitors. So now that you don't have that direct competition, and you're not sort of vying for territorial expansion directly, you can see that the West is having some issues, simply because if you don't have a purpose or you don't have a specific path, what ends up happening oftentimes is that same banking sector, that same insurance sector, tends to feed on itself. We now have negative interest rates, things that never should have happened. And the reason for that, again, is in 1991, when the Soviet Union collapsed, you know, the United States found itself, you know, in pole position with no one else behind it. And then, ironically, since then, has done exactly what the Soviets used to say about the West, which was that its decadence would be its downfall in the end. Without the competition, you see exactly that that's happened. That's exactly what's happened. You've got record low interest rates, IPOs that are basically, you know, almost frauds, you know, whether it's almost frauds, to the extent that the idea is quite interesting, but again, the implementation is problematic. Whether it's Theranos, whether it's WeWork, even Airbnb possibly, because it doesn't, you know, if you have a company that's valued, that you give a valuation to in the private market, which is not transparent, of say $30 billion, you can easily see that how easy it would be to simply have, you know, a U.S. credit card system where you just buy online, you know, rent just units, and you claim to have stayed there, but of course, you know, you don't actually, it's possible that you don't actually go there, and then you give a 5-star review. Everyone seems to benefit from that structure, especially people within city centers that have bought out these properties in anticipation of property increases. And a lot of the time, because of the banking sector, because of interest rates, a lot of these properties are snapped up by whoever happens to be there, whoever happens to have a relationship with the banking sector. So a lot of that property in the city center, one of the reasons it all looks the same is because a lot of the owners are connected to each other in the same way, and they're also connected to politicians. And so that brings me to my last point, is that the reason that church is in the middle of most of the European and Latin American and South American squares is because that's who was supplying the finance. Those were the venture capitalists. And what ended up happening was a sleight of hands where they would enter into a country with the military intending to steal natural resources, anything shiny. And in order to prevent that, in order to create something, what we would call propaganda now, but it's concrete propaganda, and to prevent a backlash, they would build schools. The Jesuits would come in, the academic order would come in and build things, like a church, roads, and like I said, schools. A lot of that would then inject the language into that particular community, oftentimes replacing a lot of the local culture, simply because when you have an excessive amount of money compared to the local competition, it's the same thing as the Soviet Union's downfall. It eventually ends up being sort of weakened over time in terms of influence. And so when you create these kinds of environments, you know, you can also see that if you go all the way back, you know, the church was in Catholic Church especially, had access to the military because it had access to a direct line to the legitimacy of kings. And all these places in Europe at one point were owned by or ruled by royalty, whether it was the Habsburgs, there's all kinds of, you know, orders. You see the order of this, the order of that. All of that is essentially a code name for an offshoot of a governmental unit that's tied into the venture capitalists at the time. You know, whether it's the Dutch East India Company, you know, somebody has to finance all these things. And a lot of times, at least if you go back far enough before these corporate entities, before the stock market, in many cases, it's basically the church. And that, of course, creates a lot of issues simply because if the church is the only one that reads Latin and nobody else does until Martin Luther shows up, it then creates a very, very interesting paradigm that allows the church to sort of puppeteer a lot of rulers and kings, especially if they're the only ones with access to literature. And you notice one of the reasons Shakespeare is so spectacular is because, you know, he's one of the first sort of bodies of literature that is incredible. But if you try to go back far enough, you've got, you know, Beowulf, you have a lot of other things, but they're just not very good. They're quite simple. And it wasn't really until the printing press came out around the 1600s, that you started to see a lot more talent being developed. And so, you know, you've got this sleight of hand where the church, you know, even in the Crusades, when the Muslims took over Jerusalem, it was Pope Urban II that actually said, called in the Crusades to go in and take it back. And then I believe Saladin, who might have been Kurdish, went back and retook it. And you have this sort of, you know, battle between a lot of different empires trying to get the same thing. But you can also see that, you know, the history is quite interesting. But if you're starting to think that, you know, we're unique in some way, we're not. It's just that the church has been replaced by venture capitalists, by construction firms, by unions. It's a little bit more diversified, but it's still the same system where you go in to exploit the locals using techniques that you've learned back, you know, before them, back in your own home country, and you're trying to export that culture, that language, and those methods into a new place in order to establish yourself and your ways of doing things, which are oftentimes connected to the banking sector. And the way you do that, in the old days, you would conquer them and put them in debt, and we call those reparations. Now, like I said, we're not so different. We go in to help somebody get somebody elected, and then put those countries, the governments, in debt through their politicians that sign off on agreements to build things that in many cases don't make any sense. On the way here, I went through Serbia, and they're building this monstrosity that they call progress right around the riverfront in Belgrade. And it's terrible. I mean, the buildings are all, they look nice, but you've got this massive building next to the water, blocking a lot of the views. But you can see how, again, if you're trying to export your way of doing things, we don't need to steal anything anymore. What you can do with the banking sector, a developed banking sector, or the developed insurance sector, is that you can, with that sleight of hand, you're in a position where you put the local, you get the local politicians elected. This is a flaw in democracy, where a lot of times the money, whether it's overt or not transparent, then it allows you essentially a cut of the till. The taxpayer revenue then comes to you and your friends, and if you can get the same buildings erected with the same designs and then the same language, and then eventually you get a McDonald's down there instead of something else, And if you go all the way back, and you think about, you know, that human potential, you start to realize that a lot of who you are, and a lot of the way you think, and a lot of the reason you're wherever you are, is due to circumstance. Because if there isn't a lingerie factory in Sevenica, maybe Melania does not become a model. Maybe she becomes like her parents, you know, manual laborers. Maybe she goes someplace else and becomes somebody else, but certainly won't make it all the way down out to the White House or a position of power. And so you can see that, you know, in the same sort of modern manifestation for Bill Gates, you know, and you have that access to capital. You have a very different timeline, a very different opportunity timeline than anybody else in that neighborhood. And the real question with development and what's not happening now is how to change all of that. Because what's happening now is the exact same thing that's been happening in the past, where you're not really concerned with the development of human potential. What you're concerned about is maintaining those banking sector, that insurance sector across borders, in ways that cement, in ways that allow you not to steal directly, you can't do that anymore, but to put people in debt in ways that harm them in the long term. And you can see that all over Europe, where all these capital cities are looking exactly the same, to the point where even the architecture, in some cases, is a direct copy. And the vastness of this transnational enterprise cannot be understated, because there's a design in Reno, Nevada. It's the best building. Well, it's not really a building. It's just a design. That's the exact same cover design for a building all the way out in Kazakhstan. So you can see that all these players in the capital city, all these players are now, you know, on the same trajectory, where they're not necessarily thinking about development. They're thinking about exporting what they've done before and what's worked before in order to maintain what the Soviet Union warned everybody about, in the sense of having this decadent lifestyle, this decadent system that wasn't necessarily concerned with practicality, with bridges, with roads, with getting a supply chain, and developing a supply chain that allowed everyone to eat properly, to have the best coffee. All of that was the goal of the Soviet Union. And today, ironically, it's something that capitalism has produced. But because of the way it's done that, the concentration of wealth within most places is highly problematic. And the question is, what is going to change? The CEO of Patagonia talks about changing it on a local level. He had an interview where he talked about the fact that there's only been a few companies that have lasted more than 100 years, and there are zero American companies on that list. That's a bit of an unfair sort of comparison, simply because the United States is only a few hundred years old. But his point was actually that all these companies started out doing something different and then evolved over time. And of course, you have to have a relationship with the banking sector where you can roll over your debt and get that trust and get those consumers on your side as you morph into something else. But I don't think that, I think the problem with idealists like him is they don't understand that there's trillions of dollars now that have to be paid back. And when you owe trillions of dollars that are now the foundation of your banking sector and economy, you're really creating, I don't know how you overcome that. And I've thought a lot about this, but I just don't know how you overcome that. Simply because if you have a lot of the same players with the same banks, how do you prevent a system where everything becomes the same, simply because you are too big to fail across borders? And how do you prevent a system where, with a democratic system and a media system where you can get, with enough money, a lot of people elected, or your own preferred politicians appointed? If you have to get them appointed first before they get elected, a lot of that requires money, whether it's a democratic system or a non-democratic system. And so you start to see this whole system, this whole political idealism of democracy being a better system, as not necessarily true. It creates, in fact, an opportunity for outsiders to influence your own politicians in ways that may not benefit locals in the long term. And so the question is how you overcome that, and that's what I'm thinking about. But right now we have a political system that operates as a cover for a very old system where the military, in alliance with the banking sector, would go in and then create and steal resources, but do it in a way that claimed progress by putting in the academics and the construction crews and the manual laborers to build things, to make things look better than they were before, while putting the politicians in debt, whether it's through a forced signature on a banking agreement, whether it's simply having buying things at a discount, which happened with the Native Americans in the United States, right? They signed something not being legally minded. Next thing they know, they're essentially in a ghetto on their own land where they were there first. It's a pattern that keeps happening and it's continuing to happen now, where this progress is now creating a backlash because of the inequality and segregation that is created. And how do you fix that before, you know, it's too late? And I think one of the greatest arguments that pessimists have is that when you're trillions of dollars into a system, it may in fact be too late. But I'm not sure that's true. I think that, you know, you have to create a new paradigm that recognizes that the debt has to be paid back and then tries to create a system around it that allows an opportunity, as much opportunity for human development as you possibly can, so that you don't end up with these one-offs, with just a one Melania having access to a lot of different things in the world. You have a system where, you know, where you don't have an education system where if you happen to be liked by the power structure that happens to be in effect at the time, you get a good education and somebody else doesn't. There has to be a change in that sense, and that's the question that a lot of us have to deal with, whether you're in the UN, whether you're in UNESCO, or any organization that claims to be international or philanthropic.